I will start with this. There is an effort when there is comparison. That's from Krishnamurti, and I like it. There is an effort when there is comparison. And in the clinic, we can see how much our body is carrying the burden because of the sessions, because of demands. So I kind of like that. That things, I mean, I'm speaking with Penny about these things also, but things should be happening with ease, especially analysis. I will comment a few things that they will connect later in the process of the seminar. I will use something that it's many Lacanian colleagues that I speak with, another psychoanalyst from other orientations. They have a peculiar idea of what is love, according to my taste. I will not mention names, but I would say that there was an incident recently where the one analyst spoke to a group of analysts about the reception of psychoanalysts in the session. And immediately the other psychoanalyst says, "My analysants are not my lab objects." Well, of course, the response had nothing to do with what was mentioned. But if I was there, I would say, well, they should be your lab objects. They should be. But in what way? First of all, what was mistaken there by that particular analyst is that love has to be in the level of the object. That what we consider love has to be the other, or whatever we love, has to be an object. It's as if there is an equation for love that says love is when we have an object, which is a very pessimistic way of love. And it reminded me of a chemist that I met in the United States. And she was a professor of chemistry, and she would still say that there is no love, everything is chemicals. Okay, but if we consider what is love precisely, of course we can find a thousand definitions, but I consider what is happening between this sphere, this space of analysis as love, because the analyst is trying to have specific reactions, whatever we are doing is because we want to facilitate the space so they can create something, do something with their desire. I consider that love. And it's a love without this object. Also, I will use Francine now because I agree with what she said, but a few years ago she says that there is no other way to want to be an analyst other than to transmit what you experience. I consider that love also. It doesn't have to be erotic love or love with an object, but this Francine, I would assume, or me, or a few other people that I know, they want to do this transmission because they experience some sort of love, but without placing the other in the place of the object. That's the contrary. So I will say to that lady these things, and I will tell them, well, you should consider your analysis as objects of your love. The reason she reacted, I believe, is that a lot of psychoanalysts or practitioners, psychotherapists, whatever, they are coming from this atheistic, pessimistic position. Okay. They consider Lacan also an atheist. Maybe he said he's an atheist, but even if he said that, if you read his seminars, especially specific ones like that, in every page, almost there is 2-3 times he mentions the word God. So without saying anything against that, but why this attachment with that? Why this, maybe not attachment, but what is reference to God? Why this reference to the resurrected body of Christ? I'm not saying that we are doing something with religion, but this particular way of atheistic position leads to the idea that love is, it's something that it's whatever, has an object, it's not pure love. I said yesterday about the Francis of Assisi. Please read that chapter. And Freud is very precise in the exception. And that's the position, the place of the analyst, actually, to love. In that way of creating, facilitating desire, everybody who comes to the session the same. Okay? So, I would propose a new atheism. Okay? It's not the atheism of that Lacan said, and I think he would love that because he liked when we, from what I learned, that we didn't repeat what he said. He said about the true atheist does not say that God does not exist, but that God is unconscious. He plays God in their conscious. basically he gave a direction how to work. But let's think of that. You know that I speak a lot about psychoanalysis has to have an orientation towards the act, and that desire equals act. You cannot separate it, because then you've got the empty speech that I will speak later. The new Athen says, a God who exists, all powerfully speaks, but cannot act. Okay? So we can articulate, speak of everything, but we remove our body from this equation. A few years ago, I said about these things to Jacques-Alain, and I liked his response. It's what I believe also, but I was pleased that he saw the same thing, because I value his. His experience with psychoanalysis. And Richard Klein told me that so the act goes to the subject. Because there is this lack of act there, in God, in their conscience, whatever, then the act, the responsibility of the act goes to the subject. And this is the orientation of psychoanalysis. So, then I will speak about division now. Many times I say that there is no lack, there is no absence, there is only what I use in the Greek word. It's from the New Testament, actually, the word, but it means parousia. I like the word parousia because it has the bar, which has to do with presence, of ousia, the word ousia there from Aristotle. Lacan mentions that word a lot, especially in the Seminar of the Act. He refers to that, the word ousia. In this way that related to philosophy, of course, in the context of psychoanalysis. So when there is only presence, I got a question, I think it was from Baruch Klein a few years ago. So where does the division of the subject goes? If you've got only presence. So the division of the subject goes to, instead of saying, I mean, of course you will have that, you are divided by what you are saying, and they're conscious, it's the division goes between act and apraxia. And I believe in the next decades, I think it's already started for sure this decade, we've got a lot of analysts who they speak, they have no problem. I said yesterday also that Miller was brilliant by naming ordinary psychosis. But what we experience there, it's a speech that forecloses the act. Okay, I will stick here more precisely. I said yesterday about the no reverse of, sorry, I made some comments yesterday that were part of my seminar. So there is no reverse of psychoanalysis. If the orientation is the act, what is the act there? I said the true word. Lacan says that the Lacan, psychoanalysis aim is the appearance of the true word. In Greek is a pragmatiki lexis. I like the Greek phrase, but the true word. For me, the true word is the act. Okay? The act is, what is the act? It's a discourse that has no semblance. He says that you cannot repeat it. So, and he makes a big separation between doing and the act. So if there is a reverse, let's take it onto that level. If there is a reverse of psychoanalysis or an upside down, which I don't believe there is, but if there is, and the orientation is towards the act, then the reverse of this is apraxia. The subject can situate itself either in the direction orientation of the act or towards apraxia. What is apraxia? It's wanting, wishing, speaking, but there is no act. This is the empty speech. To speak, to wish, to want, but to subtract your own responsibility and your body from this, because you have to act, you have to do stuff in life. Okay, I'm not speaking about cognition. And when we mark a few things in psychoanalysis, they say, okay, but I spoke, what to do now? If you hear this thing in the sessions that I spoke, I understood it, but what to do now? It means that this subject is refusing to act, because from your experience as an analyst or as an analyst, when something is marked, it leads consciously or unconsciously to changes. It's real what is happening there.